Welcome to Mental Health Matters. This is Tom Duff, Executive Director, Licensed Clinical Social Worker, Therapist to the Stars. I always say that, but, well, I'm not going to tell any of my secrets. Anyway, welcome to Mental Health Matters. We are with St. Louis Counseling, stlouiscounseling.org. That saint is spelled out, so stlouiscounseling.org. Check us out. Go to our website. If you're curious about sponsoring this podcast, maybe you're a business, maybe you're just an individual who wants to keep this podcast going, contact us and contact specifically Debbie Dugan, that's D-D-U-G-A-N, at C-C-S-T-L. So, you know, this podcast is about breaking down stigma. It's about educating the public about mental health issues. It's about just bringing the conversation to the table. It's about making mental health okay to talk about around the kitchen table, around the water cooler. It is okay to talk about. And we do that by having entertaining and interesting guests. And today is no exception. We have Katie Robberson.
Robberson.
I'm sorry, Robberson, right?
That's okay.
I'm from Illinois.
So what,
you are too. Oh, I can't even use that excuse. Darn it anyway.
That's okay.
So Katie, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming on. And Katie actually was connected to us from one of our other podcasts, a good friend of her sister, Chelsea, who was on a couple weeks ago on our podcast. And you know, well, you kind of know Chelsea. Your sister knows her better, right?
Right, correct.
So you're not going to have any of the real scoop stories on Chelsea.
She just has a lot of children.
Yeah, God bless her.
I know.
A lot of children under the age of like five, right? Yeah, so crazy. So, but that's the beauty of the podcast is because then all of a sudden we're connected to somebody else, right? And who has a great story to share, which we'll get into here today. But so in your daytime job, right? You're an instructor at SIUE. What college do you teach?
So I teach in our school business, and I teach mostly management. I teach our majority of our undergraduates, and then I have every once in a while they let me teach marketing.
Which one of those do you like most?
It's a toss-up. Uh-huh. Probably I like to get out of my cave and teach marketing every once in a while because I teach our Teams course and our business communications course every semester, no matter what.
Now, how long have you been doing that?
I have been at SIUE since July of 2012.
Oh, wow. Now, were you always like on this level of instructor,
no,
teacher?
No, prior to that, I was in the corporate world for about a decade.
Wow. So
I like education.
Uh-huh. I hear that a lot from people.
Yes.
Probably very different environments.
It is. I don't travel and I'm, you know, home more and I can be more mom, you know, mm-hmm. a little more flexible.
So that's where kind of that business, why you're in the business department, that was kind of the career you had before.
Correct.
Teaching.
Yep.
And all that.
Yep.
So awesome. So I'm sure, you know, we're just starting to get into the world of placing college or placing clinical therapists on college campuses. We're doing some stuff with St. Charles Community College. But that need, of course, I'm sure you see there as well, too, just
Absolutely.
Mental health in general. And you know, what we always say is mental health, everyone has mental health, and we need to, like, realize that, because a lot of times people are like, well, I don't have mental health, and I'm like, I didn't say a mental illness, I'm like, mental health, just as we have physical health as well, too.
Right, we all have bad mental health days, whether we have a mental illness or not.
Mm-hmm. So. Exactly, the ups and downs, the ebbs and flows.
Yep.
So yeah, your daytime job is that, right, with
yes.
SIUE, but also you're this advocate. You're this advocate for mental health.
I try to advocate, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I went and got my instructor certification for adult and youth mental health first aid because I just saw a need for more conversation around mental health. And I have created a small group locally of some parents, mostly moms, that we communicate mostly via Facebook about challenges our kids have within the mental illness kind of realm.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess I could call myself an advocate.
Yeah, I think you are. Yeah, yeah. You start calling yourself that.
Okay.
That's important, and that's good. So for you, being the mom, right, mm-hmm. of somebody who has some challenges with mental health, right?
Correct.
So that's where it kind of, where it started, right?
Yes and no. So I actually had pretty profound panic disorder in graduate school. Mm-hmm. So I have some lived experience with that mm-hmm. and understand it from that personal perspective. But then as a mom, really have learned just how hard it is for a family that has a child with a mental illness or an invisible disability to kind of navigate their way through school, to navigate relationships, how to really make your child as successful as possible given their limitations at certain times.
You know, you mentioned panic mm-hmm. disorder, right? So explain that for somebody who maybe go,
So 1 in 5 people have a panic attack. And if you've had one, you probably know it and you probably remember it. But panic disorder is where it becomes way more frequent. And so for me, my panic attacks could occur daily, could occur multiple times a day when I was really sick. And the disorder behavior really comes from worrying about having another panic attack. And so I became close to agoraphobic. I would really only go to school and work because I knew I had to. Mm-hmm. But other than that, I didn't want to leave my safe space, which was my one-room apartment mm-hmm. during graduate uh-huh. school. So I, that was really my early 20s. Even my young professional life, I struggled a lot with panic. And there was no trigger for me, so I couldn't mm-hmm. prevent. The panic attacks would just kind of come out of anywhere, even if I was sleeping. Mm-hmm. And so a panic attack feels very similar to what we think a heart attack might feel like. So there's, you can sweat, your heart can race, your respiratory rate increases. For me, I really had every symptom. I had I felt out of body. I oftentimes felt like I was dying. And then I eventually learned to just get really angry at my panic attack. Mm-hmm. And I don't even really understand fully how I got out of it because I didn't necessarily go to therapy when I probably should have, mm-hmm. But I was a grad student, so.
Yeah, you got it handled, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I figured it out eventually. Mm-hmm. But.
So, yeah, it is interesting because I think I've come across a lot of people that said exactly what you say. Like, I'm not exactly sure what was the turning point. I'm not sure what happened. And sometimes it's that ability for our own cognitive functioning, our own cognitive mind and that logical sense to take over. But yeah, I've heard that from several different people.
And I can still have them on occasion. It's rare. And now if I have one, I know it's coming. I always describe it kind of like anybody that's ever had labor or witnessed labor where you feel like the beginning coming, right? The beginning of a contraction. Well, I could sense the beginning of a panic attack. Mm-hmm. And there's the really heightened part, but you always know that it's going to end. And so I think with that experience of just knowing it's going to end, right? That has taught me a lot of how to recognize the different signs in my body and, really kind of work through, okay, well, you feel this way because your stomach's upset, or you feel this way because, you almost got hit by a car, whatever it mm-hmm. is. You can start to recognize those physical symptoms for what they are.
Mm-hmm. So a big part of that is just that knowing yourself and being aware of your different emotions or sensations in your body,
right.
Which is a great intervention technique for mm-hmm. that. Awesome. So then, like you said, so that kind of led you to an understanding of a mental health, event or issue, right? And then helping your son kind of navigate not only that, but probably the system as well, is my guess.
The system is not set up for kids with mental illness, and it's no fault really of the system. It's just there's only so many resources to go around. And depending on the school district you're in or the type of school you're in, navigating those resources can be really challenging. My son was always anxious. And when I look back on when he was young, 4, 5, 6, there were certain behaviors that we just always chalked up to behavior, right? Like, oh, he's just misbehaving. But looking back, they're really from a point of anxiety. He spilled a drink one time in a restaurant and threw a fit and ran off into the bathroom. Well, it's because he was embarrassed, and mm-hmm. in your parent brain, you're just thinking, I've done something wrong, right? I didn't teach him how to act properly. But now we've really come to such a realization of how his anxiety presents that I can go back and look at so many things. He's 13 now, but so many things over the course of his childhood that I think were probably triggered by anxiety.
And so, I mean, that's one of the other things we all always talk about in counseling is, you know, looking at the meaning behind that behavior. Like when you pointed out, like, you know, the drink spilled in the restaurant and then him running away, it's like, oh, I see, just upset or embarrassed. But, you know, what does that really mean?
Right.
And it is a different mindset, you know, because when you have to dive into that on that level.
For sure. And I'm a very, like, pick yourself up, brush yourself off kind of person. And I've had to learn how to scale a lot of that back with him. And I think that's probably been the biggest challenge as a parent, to understand that maybe your expectations aren't fair at certain times. And maybe they're not even appropriate, you know, given the challenge that your child is experiencing.
So it's kind of like retooling yourself to parent a child that is, for whatever, whoever your child is, you know, whatever they might be dealing with, you've got to retrain yourself in some sense.
Yes. And it's made me a lot more compassionate with my college students too. Not that I didn't, I always liked to hear kind of, or asked them to explain why they missed an assignment or why they didn't show up to class or whatever it is. But, you know, now recognizing how much an external influence can have over someone in a classroom or in the work environment, and to really be cognizant of that, and see if there are supports that they need outside of class to make them a more successful student. So it's really impacted, I'd say, pretty much everything I do.
Which, you know, because I'm a big believer in growth, you know, as an individual, we can always grow no matter what age we are and how set we're in our ways, but it really makes you just a better person too.
Absolutely.
I imagine, like you're saying, because that's carrying over into your work environment as well too.
Because I had things said to me when I was struggling that were so hurtful, that you don't even realize they're hurtful in the moment. And now looking back, I'm like, holy cow. Like, I'm sure I said things, and I can remember saying things to my son, like, why are you so upset? Like, look at everything you have. Well, it doesn't matter, right?
Yeah.
You could have $1 million and everything you've ever wanted, but if you're depressed, it doesn't matter, because depression isn't based on what you have or, you know, things that you could do. And so it's been a learning curve.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
For sure. And it still is. I know we're not perfect in any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah. Cause you know, I think, you know, I was kind of brought up the same way. You pull yourself up by your bootstraps, figure it out, get going, rub some mud on it. You'll be fine. You know, that whole thing. And it is a different mindset. That's very challenging. How do you think you, like, what kind of made you realize, like, okay, wait a minute, I got to change something about me? Because not everyone gets that.
Well, I think, you know, my son, although he's young, I always tease him that he has the emotions sometimes of like a 5 or 6 year old, but the cognitive skills of like a mid-20s to early 30s. Like, he's a young adult, essentially, and it always has been. He's an old soul. And so it was probably at his sickest, so the fall of 2018, he was out of school for suicidality and homebound and in intensive outpatient therapy. And we're sitting in the driveway after he had run out of the house angry. And he said, nobody listens to me. Everything everyone's doing for me is making me worse. And I've told you for months that it's making me worse and nobody's listening to me. And I thought, that's really unfair, right? He's the patient. He's the one that needs the support, and we're just telling him that he's going to get better, but we're not really asking him if anything's working. And so from that point forward, it really became about engaging him and validating his experience and trying to understand what was helpful to him. So we changed medicines, we changed doctors, we changed a lot of things based on that conversation.
And then in return, you're giving him that voice. You're giving him some ownership over himself, some accountability, you know, with his. Yeah, so that's great. So kind of, so for you, it kind of helped helped hearing him, like, listening, that part, you know. So so we as parents and the adults, like, we have to listen to your kids, even though sometimes we're like, well, we're the adult and they're the kid. You know, that's the way it works, right?
Yeah, and I think that's the big challenge, like, having experienced mental illness myself, I wanted to say, well, I understand how you feel. But that's really, and that's a lot of what I've learned over the past year and a half, is that's not really fair to say to him, because I don't know. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how anyone with mental illness feels. I only know how I felt when I was struggling. And so that has been a huge learning curve that I think both my husband and I have had to really kind of take a step back and think about the fact that there's, no matter what our life experiences are, how similar they may have been to his, they're not his. Mm-hmm. And I think as parents, we want to be able to fix it. So we want to say, hey, look, this happened to me and I survived, or the same exact thing occurred and this is what I did. But that's not always helpful. Especially to an adolescent.
Yes. Yeah.
Maybe when they're six or seven, you can say, oh, you'll be fine. I know, but when they become, you know, even early adolescents, they really need some ownership in their path.
Mm-hmm. So as a mom, as a parent, right, what can you tell other parents? So parents, sometimes they take it on, right? Like, this is my fault. This is how, what happened? What did I do wrong? What, you know, my kid is struggling with something. How can I help them? So a lot of times they take that on. And in the sense of, like, they feel guilty, they feel responsible. They did something wrong. What kind of advice can you give to parents to help them walk through that?
So I still have that sometimes. Uh-huh. And I think I always will. But I will tell you, coming from a place of trying to find solidarity with other parents and just sharing experiences, knowing that oftentimes there's other people that are struggling in the very same way you are, and recognizing that it's not, you know, you might think someone's an excellent parent, but here they have a child that's struggling, and you're able to build kind of that camaraderie. Mm-hmm. And the relationship where you can understand that it's really a team effort. And mm-hmm. it's that old, you know, saying about the village, you know, the stronger your village, the better off you are. But I think the guilt is always there, because I still will wonder, you know, gosh, is this something we should have picked up in second, third, fourth grade? Mm-hmm. Were there things we could have done when he was younger that would have prevented his struggles now? So I don't know that the guilt ever goes away, but I think learning that that's a piece of it that you just kind of have to carry with you,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
is where the point I'm at. Yeah. Maybe someday I won't feel guilty.
Yeah.
But I
yeah.
haven't reached it yet.
No, that's great to hear exactly where you're at. And,
yeah.
And, you know, like you said too, that community, that you're not alone. Mm-hmm. And that's the other thing with mental health issues and mental illness, is I think a lot of times even people who are experiencing them, a lot of times feel like, I'm the only one that's feeling this way, because we know there's a stigma attached to it and you don't share it. And then on this level, even if someone who's taking care of somebody and trying to navigate the system, you're not alone also, you know.
It's a very lonely experience. It's not something that you talk about. And I'm very close to my parents, but when my son was at his sickest, I was afraid to tell them how sick he was. Because I didn't want them to worry. And so then you start to kind of really just hold it all in yourself, which isn't healthy,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
But it is a very lonely experience. And what's interesting through this little group on Facebook that I've started is just the number of parents just locally that'll say, oh my gosh, I never thought anybody else was experiencing this. And, you know, just within our little, you know, community, I know of four children my son's age and grade at school who are struggling with the very same thing.
Wow.
And so to have those parents, and we'll, you know, exchange text messages of support, or, you know, communicate back and forth and check in on each other. And, you know, I will tell you that that's so helpful to know that you're not alone.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and earlier you were saying, like, yeah, I guess I could call myself an advocate. Yes, you're an advocate. Look what you're doing. You got a group together. You're forming support. You're forming community. So that's awesome. Mm-hmm. So then, and you also became a mental health first aid trainer, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, and adult and children. So yep. That's cool that you're with both. So explain to our listeners out there, like, what does that mean?
So a mental health first aid is a program that actually started in Australia in 2001. And I don't know how familiar you are with MHFA, but it's similar to like a CPR or a life first aid, like a mm-hmm. first aid course. but it's for folks experiencing mental health challenges. And the training that someone goes through to make them a first aider is an 8-hour training, and they leave with an actionable plan, just like you would leave CPR with a plan. But within mental health first aid, the action plan is called ALGI. Mm-hmm. So you're taught the skills to assess for risk of suicide or harm, to listen non-judgmentally. The G is give reassurance and information. The E is encourage appropriate professional help. And then the second E is encourage self-help and other support strategies. And the training is really taught to help you know which part of the action plan you should use, because you're not always going to assess someone for risk of suicide or harm, and you're not always going to, you know, encourage professional help. It might just be that somebody's having a little rough patch, right? So you're there to listen and you're there to reassure. But I found the training actually in the middle of the night one night when I was just researching ways to help my son. Mm-hmm. And so I went and became certified as an instructor here actually at UMSL, with the Missouri Institute of Mental Health. Missouri is one of two states in the U.S. that brought mental health first aid here in 2008. And so I went through their training to become an instructor and adult in June of last year. And then in October of last year, became a youth instructor as well. And so I've taught now our public library. I taught a course for Representative Bristow and Alton. I've done a couple youth courses. I've taught the higher ed model, so you can get a designation in different populations. So I've taught the higher ed model on campus to our athletic department, and I'm actually participating in writing a grant right now within SIU-E to bring more mental health awareness to campus in general, an additional person in our counseling services, and then bring some training too. So it's really become kind of this passion project of mine.
It's almost like you're an advocate.
Almost. I'm getting there.
Mental Health First Aid is an awesome program. We have a couple people certified at our agency that's doing some of the teaching as well too. But what I'm always interested in too is when you're teaching it, right? And so like some unique, and what's cool about it is it's for anybody,
right?
Anybody. And so I heard you mention athletics. Mm-hmm. I heard you mention public library. So when you're introducing this topic, right, what are some of the responses you get, or what's some of the, like when you're just kind of analyzing the audience, right? Like, what are you feeling off of them?
So I think one of the most interesting groups I've done the first two classes are probably the ones that resonate with me the most, probably because I was the most nervous, right? Uh-huh. But I did a dental practice, and it was really interesting just to hear. So they shared a lot of their own personal stories, but just to hear the things that go on in a dental practice that you would never know, like somebody having a panic attack, right, in a dental chair, and how do they handle that? Someone telling the hygienist they're going to go home and end their life, right? You know, so you don't, when you go to the dentist, you don't think about that. But really it impacts everywhere. When you start to make those connections, you start to have those conversations. I've yet to have someone say to me, well, I don't know anybody that has mental illness. That hasn't happened yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I've trained 175 people. That hasn't happened yet. Uh-huh. And then I did two trainings actually for a corporation in South County. Mm-hmm. And these are, you know, fellow employees. One man is the director of IT. And, you know, people that wouldn't necessarily have these conversations, but by the end of the 8 hours walk out with a completely different understanding of each other, but also of how to approach their employees that are needing help. And so that company is really cool. They're kind of on, I feel like, the forefront of mental health in the workplace as far as corporations. They offered the training twice to, you know, different groups of employees, and have set up kind of different opportunities for employees that are struggling.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, so it's like that. So when we start understanding, it's almost like if we start understanding each other and what makes other people tick. And you mentioned non-judgmental listening,
yes,
right?
Yep.
It's like things can improve, you know? And I think so. Sometimes, I don't know, I don't want to get all philosophical, but it's like, you know, we're so far apart on so many levels now, it feels like, even from the media and, you know, and the different levels of politics. It's like, if we just slow down and think and understand each other and listen to each other, things can improve. You
right,
know.
And that's true even if you don't have a mental illness,
yeah.
right?
Amen, yeah.
Just the ability to listen and to listen for understanding, which is, you know, that famous quote, but not just to hear what somebody is saying, but to actually listen and understand, I think, is completely different. We can go into a lot of conversations already knowing, right, what the person's going to say
mm-hmm.
if we choose to.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, and just for example, the dental practice, right? Totally makes sense after you say it.
Oh, like absolutely.
From a mental health, I'm like,
yes.
Oh, yeah, because I'm always tense when I go in there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so just understanding just anxiety. If you're, you know, yes, you're trained to you know, be a dentist or a dental hygienist, but the training for the mental health side and people is a whole different animal at
yeah.
times.
My favorite part of teaching now is when I get the emails or the messages like a few days or a week or so later that say, oh my gosh, I just algae'd someone, you know, like I just used the action plan. And it's cool to see that connection, because a lot of times we'd almost freeze and not know what to do,
mm-hmm.
or we would, you know, pass it along on to someone else that we felt might be able to handle it better. But most higher education institutions, counseling services are overwhelmed. Just like the public school systems, you know, counseling services are overwhelmed, and to train just a regular everyday person to be able to at least hold space with somebody while they're waiting for a professional, I think is really awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I think the program would be great if we could get as many people trained as CPR.
Yeah. Think about that. and it's just as important. I mean, you can argue that point, I guess, if someone's needing CPR,
I mean,
but still,
right.
I mean, life or death on a lot
of
those
levels.
Situations.
Yep.
But, and I think that's where, you know, in corporate America, and it's not just nonprofits, that's kind of understanding this world. And it's not just education, but like people in their everyday practice, you know, from the auto mechanic, you know, when we talk about building a trauma-informed community and understanding mm-hmm. each other and the way we respond, just because this customer might be yelling at us, like, doesn't mean we should yell back, because it's just going to make it worse.
Right.
So how do we intervene on the right level?
Yep. Nope, you're absolutely right.
So navigating, jumping back to
sure.
how you've been trying to help your son, right? School systems and, you know, like we've talked about, overburdening the school system and under-resourced, you know, at times and things of that nature. And then the mental health system, trying to get help. What have you found to be successful in how to walk down those paths? Or maybe what are the challenges?
I think both have unique challenges. As far as mental health care, that system is abysmal, as you know. The wait times, the access, the cost, and, you know, I feel fortunate that, you know, I had friends in the right places that could help us find, you know, treatment. We had the resources. My job was flexible that I could, you know, get him where he needed to go. I think about those families that don't have that, you know, ability to take time off work to put a child in an intensive program, or whose child might have to be hospitalized, and what a struggle that might be for a family. The wait times are frustrating for everyone, but I think especially as a parent where you feel so lost. Our pediatrician was a good starting point for us, but was not going to be a successful long-term solution. And so finding a child psychiatrist really took some trial and error for us. The same with a therapist. Our son didn't do well with CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, just didn't suit him.
Mm-hmm.
And our CBT therapist was phenomenal, and I could use her. I love her. She's a wonderful person, and, you know, he liked her on that level, but it just that therapy wasn't helpful to him, and so he had to kind of continue to look for the right fit. And he's in exposure response right now, and we'll see what happens there.
Mm-hmm.
But the school system, you know, I grew up the daughter of two public educators, and so I've always been pretty passionate about public school and have been pretty involved in my kids' schools. And so I think I had a little bit of a benefit in that I knew how to access certain people or certain resources or where to go with questions, and I wasn't afraid to ask them. But I think for a lot of times for parents, they just don't even know where to go.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the first step, is knowing who at the school is the advocate that you can reach out to, because it may not even be the school psych or the social worker. It might be a teacher. It might be a principal. You know, there's any number of people. My son started struggling at the beginning of middle school, so it was a new school to all of us. And I tell the office staff all the time, they are like our angels, because they really met him where he was. Mm-hmm. And if he needed to be in the office all day, he was in the office all day. And if he could only make it through a few hours of class, they kept him. You know, they didn't ship him back home, because they really recognized the importance of keeping him in the building. Mm-hmm. And I think on a lot of levels, they were counseling me in some ways,
yeah.
You know,
providing
a little bit of respite, and also making me remain strong, maybe when I would have rather gone to pick him up.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we were fortunate that we fell into a school that, even if it wasn't their job title, they kind of knew how to help.
Mm-hmm. So that importance of communication, support, and accepting it as well, too.
Right.
And being open to that feedback, or like you said, like, you know, they're kind of like, oh, that's probably, let's wait it out a little bit longer. I know you want to come get them. But developing those relationships and to be able to create some trust.
Right. And there are the, you know, the regulatory things like the IEP or the 504 that I've learned a whole lot about. So my middle child has a 504 for ADD. So like we believe in all mental illnesses in our house.
Got them covered,
well.
Right?
my son had neither. And what's interesting about IEP is that oftentimes, you know, parents assume they can only get it if there's an educational failure, right? If they cognitively aren't doing well. And that was never my son's case. He was straight A student going into sixth grade, never a behavior problem. And, you know, so to ask for evaluation for an IEP, people are like, well, why would you do that? I'm like, well, because he can qualify under emotional disturbance. And that's what this is. It's, you know, impeding his ability to learn because he can't stay in the classroom, and some days he can't even get to school, and he has every right to an IEP just as any other child with a disability. But I think for a lot of parents, they don't see that, and he struggles because he doesn't want to be called special, right? So
mm-hmm.
special education is a bad word with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we just talk about, you know, these are the supports you get because you have an IEP, and it's a fallback. If he were to slide even further back, we have options now. My daughter that has the 504 for ADD really just needs the accommodations of a little bit of extra time, and she's doing phenomenally right now, so who knows if she'll continue needing it, but it's nice to have those guidelines in place. And I think it's confusing to parents. I think it's scary to parents to go in and ask. And I think a lot of times people are either going to be judged for, you know, what they might see as a deficiency in their parenting or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I luckily never saw it that way, mm-hmm. I guess.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, it's a scary system to think about going into.
Yeah. And it's, you know, you alluded to kind of the stigma of it, you know, and how we perceive mental health, or if we don't want our kid to be seen differently. And then if that stigma is present, then I'm going to keep quiet about it. And then all along, there's services and doors get opened up when those IEPs mm-hmm. do exist.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what can ultimately help greater success.
Yeah, I would say probably the two hardest moments, the hardest moment has been in an IEP meeting, and the most beautiful validating moment has occurred in an IEP meeting.
Mm-hmm.
A year apart, but you know, the first time it was all, these are the goals he has to meet, and if he can't meet them, that's his problem, and you need to reinforce whatever we set up here at home. And I thought, oh my gosh, I'm bending over backwards trying to get this kid to school, and you're accusing me of not, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that was really challenging to hear. But then fast forward a year, they, you know, in the IEP meeting, they talked about, this must be a really hard path as a parent. You know, you have a child struggling that nobody understands their struggle, and really validated that experience for him. But also just talked about the fact that, you know, imagine asking someone to face their fear every single day. Even
mm-hmm.
as adults, we don't want to do that.
No, not at all.
And so here we are asking a child to do that. And I thought, wow, they get it, you know.
Yeah,
they really get
big
it.
Time. So, you know, and with that system, then it really is kind of, it's as much as you want to keep your guard up on some levels, you got to let your guard down and accept that help,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I think that's so important.
Yeah. And it further complicates, you know, when you have relationships with people in the room and dependent upon what teacher you have in the room, you know, so the IEP meeting itself can be, I think, intimidating for parents. Just because there's eight people and you're the one voice for your child.
Mm-hmm.
And that luckily for us has not been the case. They've all been very supportive after the first meeting, and I haven't had that experience, but I could see how it would feel that way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you walk in and there's these eight people that you're kind of defending your case to in a way. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I've been in those from the side of like being a case manager or a therapist mm-hmm. for an individual, and then you have all those school people, but ultimately, like, they're all just stating their side to it, and
right.
in regards to what they're reporting on, and it's like, okay, this is a team. This,
right.
Yeah, and it is a different environment.
And it should be a team, but I think a lot of times parents go in feeling it's like them against the team,
mm-hmm.
and it really, we've been fortunate we've never had that experience.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. So in the world of mental health, whether it be outpatient or intensive outpatient treatment and some of those programs, that ability, like, what's that like for you as well as like a child to reintegrate back into community or
mm-hmm.
into the family or just into the school?
So I think it's we're starting reintegration this week with my oldest. So he's been in an intensive outpatient program since January. And so he hasn't been in a full day of school since the middle of December.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of stress on him, obviously, because he's the one that has to do what he's afraid of. But I think from a family perspective, you lose that normalcy of schedule, right? So I have two other children. And so explaining to a 5-year-old and a 9-year-old why their brother doesn't have to go to school has been interesting. Now that it's the second time, it's less challenging for them. They just kind of accept it. But I think the family dynamics of an intensive program is, you know, as a professional, I sometimes feel like I'm not spending as much time on work as I should
mm-hmm.
because I'm the primary responsible person for getting him to and from treatment. My parents, luckily, right? As you talk mm-hmm. about support systems, my parents live 2 miles from us and have
That's
done
nice.
Everything they can
mm-hmm.
and take care of him on the days that I'm in the classroom. My employer has been very supportive. So I think it really is dependent upon your family situation. But there's stressors for sure, regardless of the type of therapy. You know, explaining it to a 5-year-old, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
that's interesting. Now she'll just say things like, well, will his chemicals ever be in the right place?
You
know, like, he talks pretty openly with her
uh-huh.
and says, you know, I have to go. So I learn not to be afraid of the things that shouldn't make me afraid. And so she'll just kind of say in her own little way, like, well, he's going to the doctor, so he's not afraid. You know, so she's really normalized it. And my 9-year-old really just hates anxiety. Like, she'll just say, I hate anxiety because it makes
mm-hmm.
him upset, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so she's working through it in her own way.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it definitely does change the family dynamic, and it changes community. We've had to, you know, he's lucky that he has this group of like 5 friends, and they've always been friends since kindergarten. And so we've tried to make a point to keep him engaged
mm-hmm.
with those friends in some way. Whether it's, you know, communicating through the parents and scheduling time for him to see the friends, you know, it's really something that does take a lot of thought from a parent's perspective to make sure that your child, especially at that age, you know, social networks are so important
mm-hmm.
To keep them engaged. And our school has been very open, you know, if he wants to come to a sporting event, if he wanted to come to a play, they would allow him, even though he's not in a regular attendance.
Mm-hmm.
As long as he is attending homebound instruction, then they let him kind of participate like
included.
A regular student.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. So, I mean, a big part of that is, like you were saying, you know, being real with family members, and for, you know, age appropriate real, however best you can describe it, but helping them understand this is just part of who he is, and giving them the voice as well too, it sounds like, to be able to talk it out.
Yeah. And I think, you know, my youngest was 4 when this first started happening, and well, my son at the time was a lot sicker. He didn't want me to use his name, was a lot sicker at the time. And she would just say things like, "Well, we love you, Buggy. We just love you. And you just need to be you." You know, and so even at 4, she understood that, you know, there were some differences that he was experiencing, and that her job was just to kind of be a sister. And she really hasn't changed that, you know. She's young.
Identifying those roles. Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a sister. That's what I'll be for you.
Right. Yeah. I'm here. Mm-hmm. You know, and that I think is great, because it's made them more self-aware too. My 9-year-old will come home and say, "Mom, I think so-and-so might have anxiety." And I'll say, "Why do you think that?"
Yeah.
And she'll say, "Oh, well, I noticed on the playground," you know, and she'll have this like whole story about why. And I'm like, "Huh. Okay, I'm turning you all into like little therapists."
Exactly. They're very understanding of their classmates.
Yeah,
I love it.
That's great.
The way it needs to be.
Yeah.
Can pinpoint some symptoms here and there.
Oh, yeah. And they know, I mean, we talk a lot about mental health first aid, obviously. And my youngest has struggled with some separation anxiety, so completely age appropriate.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So I draw like hearts and stars and things on her hand when she goes to school. And so one morning she drew them on mine, and she said, "Mom, I miss you when I'm at school." And I said, "You know, I miss you too. All day long I think about you, but I can't wait to hear about your adventures." And she goes, "Stop trying to be a therapist." And I thought, okay,
don't
clearly,
call them adventures. Yeah.
Clearly we talk about mental health a little too much.
The openness is great.
Yeah,
so I love it.
It.
Well, we have been here with Katie Robberson.
Robberson. You got it.
Oh, man. See, I was born in Central Illinois.
It's okay. Cops and robbers. I married into it.
Oh, Robberson.
You know,
yeah, okay. Okay. Yeah. That's a good way of remembering it that way. Well, we've been here with Katie Robberson and having some great conversation and a lot of tips and techniques as you've been talking. It's like I'm hearing a lot of great things that you've been able to kind of let people know about and different perspectives and different understandings. So it's been a great, great time meeting you. This has been awesome.
Wonderful. Thank you.
And I mean, I think we can say SIU-E instructor, right?
Yes.
Mental health first aid trainer and mental health advocate.
You gave me a new title today.
You got a new title. So this has been awesome. And looking forward to hopefully keep this conversation going with you in the future
too. Yeah.
All right. Well, this has been Mental Health Matters, and check us out at stlouiscounseling.org. Until next time, this is Tom Duff. See you later.
This has been Mental Health Matters with Tom Duff of St. Louis Counseling Services. Check out stlouiscounseling.org for more information.